So today is June 30th, 2022. My name is Karen Su, and I am interviewing Dr. Esther Shu-Shin Lee on behalf of the Houston Asian American Archive at Rice University. We're so pleased to be documenting your oral history today. So thank you so much for joining us. All right.
Thank you.
To begin, when and where were you born and what was it like in your hometown?
Oh, I was born in a very remote, small, sandy, windy town in the northwest of China. And I almost died twice due to the poor nutrition. And my mother vowed to raise me for the Lord if I survive. And she named me Faith in Chinese. And my ancestral home is Chengdu, who is famous for panda bears.
Okay, so in your background information, you had noted that you have four siblings. How would you do to describe the household that you grew up in?
Oh, I have a loving family situation. And both my parents are Christians with lots of love, support, and open-minded. And they're Western educated, so they spoke English very well, better than mine, and no discriminations against the girls, and they treat the girls and boys the same, and in all areas, in education, everything, resources. So we all siblings turn out to be very well educated and productive citizens.
That's lovely. What were your parents' occupations?
Oh, my father retired as an army general, and my very talented and Western educated mother played the piano, sang, and even performed, for benefit concerts, and taught at college, and was an entrepreneur, actually a businesswoman. Can you believe back to 1960s, early 1960s, late 50s, and she developed housing for U.S. servicemen and set up a piano studio for their kids.
What were some of the values that your parents emphasized in your upbringing?
Oh, my father always emphasized honesty and loyalty, and unlike lots of traditional father or parents who expect academic achievement, he never. And he said, health is most important. You better to have an able body and for survival. And my mother always saying, ask God for wisdom, like King Solomon, and be smart and courageous, like Queen Esther. That's why she gave my English name as Esther. I hope I have lived up with that. And in addition, she required us, not my father, but my mother, required all of us married to a Christian. That's a prerequisite. It doesn't matter the background or family or whatever, must be Christian.
Oh, wow, that's great to know where your name came from.
Yeah.
So you were born in Chengdu, China. When did you move to Taiwan, and how was the move for you?
Oh, my family, the whole family retreated to Taiwan from mainland China with the nationalist government because like I said, my father was in the army general. And so the communist China occupied China. So we retreated to Taiwan by a Navy ship in 1949, when I was about 5 years old.
What elementary school did you attend?
Well, I attended three rural elementary schools in three different cities, So I don't want to bore people with the location or geography, but anyway, some of my classmates were barefoot, And so it's you can say very primitive, and we always walk to school, through the rice paddles, paddies, field, all that kind of.
What are some favorite childhood memories you have of school, friends, or family?
It's seems like I had a very happy childhood. It seems like I was well liked by teachers and the classmates. And but I do remember my legs were shaky, very shaky, when I was first assigned to lead the national anthem for the morning, school morning, exercise or whatever, on a very high-raised platform in fifth grade. And my older sister often told me about the following story during my first grade. And one day my mother sent her to buy some bananas, and I took her along. She was about 5 years older than I was. So first grade I was maybe sixth, she was 11 years old or 12. And I helped the vendor to get rid of the flies when she was doing the selection or bargaining or whatever. And I was reluctant to leave after she paid for the bananas, because I want to get more fruits. I love fruits even up to now. And she told me that we have no money left for the fruit. So finally I left with her, and but murmuring, when I grow up, I will marry a fruit vendor. That's my solution for life. Now I am a wife of a vegetable gardener. Of course, it's retired, okay. So we have a lot of fruits and lots of vegetables. And we even grow, you know, persimmons, you name it, fruits in the backyard. Okay.
That's a lovely story.
Isn't that funny?
Yeah. Okay, so I've read about your passion playing piano as a young girl, which has continued today. And you very kindly sent us a video of you playing Chopin's Revolutionary Etude. Could you talk about your experiences learning piano as a young girl?
Well, like I said, you know, I was pretty active girl before third grade. I was more like a tomboy, and I often got into trouble fighting. I mean, literally fighting with the neighborhood boys, not girls, for so-called justice or fairness. No fair. And I came up with my fists. Yeah, and so I often got into trouble in the neighborhood. And my mother, in order to tame me like a typical lady, okay, a girl, she always been ladylike, okay. So my mother sent me to dance lessons, but no luck, okay. I was too chubby, too heavy. So the teacher just discharged me right away, said, "You are too heavy to jump up." So I said, okay. And then my mother was not discouraged. In my fifth grade class, there was a so-called privileged student whose parents were working in Hong Kong. And she and her older sister, for some reason, stayed in Taiwan alone. And they had an imported piano. At that time, you know, you only can find a piano from overseas. But no one could give them lessons. So I recommend volunteer my mother, whose minor was music in Jinling. You probably heard of Jinling Women University or College in Nanking. Instead of charging them for tuition, mother and I could practice piano daily in their house. Unfortunately, they moved to Hong Kong a year later. So my compassion for piano, playing the piano, was so strong that I had to overcome many, many obstacles to get just 30 minutes of a practice daily. And literally, I can write a book about my journey of a piano practice, but I don't think people are interested in that part of my story. And so 3 years later, my parents finally could afford and imported the piano. That's another long story, because we were not affluent, you know. In the following 5 years, I was committed to piano practice at the expense of any school leisure activities, such as reading novel or going to the movies with my classmates. And my time basically just divided between schoolwork, piano practice, and the Sunday church activities. At that time, the hymns "Living for Jesus" and "Have Thy Way, Lord" have become my guiding songs throughout my exciting life. But I like to add that I really appreciate my parents and my siblings put up with my long hours of practice. They really suffer a lot. I don't know who the Europeans are not, but you know, to prepare for concerts or performance, you got to practice repeatedly, you know. And in retrospect, I really feel sorry for them, you know, suffering at my practice.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I play piano as well, so I relate to this.
Right, and think about it's not in huge house or no insulated room, you know, all that.
Yeah, it's a lot. Okay, so on to the next question. So you've noted that you initially wanted to become a medical doctor and a concert pianist, but after you did not pass the test for medical school at the National Taiwan University, you ended up majoring in education at the National Taiwan Normal University. Why did you end up choosing education as your major?
No choice, you know, not by choice. Because let me explain at the time, this is a part of our history and of the society in Taiwan. The college entrance examination was different from that of today in Taiwan. There were only very few universities you can attend. And there were only three areas a high school graduate could select and prepare for the exam. For the only one medical school in Taiwan, students, that's a National Taiwan University. And the students had to choose area C or division C, which focuses on science that include biology, animal science, and chemistry, and so forth. And I was so confident because I thought, you know, I was a good student in high school, in the best girls' high school, first girls' high school in Taipei. And I was so confident that my first choice, medical school. So I did not pay much attention for my second or third choices of a discipline under the area or division C. Yet I failed and ended up in Taiwan National University without a choice. So it was terrible experience, setback. And I tried to come back and take again, but no luck. I mean, no courage to do that. Okay.
So thinking back to your time at National Taiwan Normal University, what were some defining moments that you had?
Not really, but I have to say at least those courses I took helped me a great deal in many practical ways. Of course, I took some pre-med courses, chemistry, biochemistry, you know, biology, advanced, you name it, to prepare for medical school, hopefully to the U.S. But I also took other courses, education, you know, and so, which is very practical, such as raising kids and family life, which I really appreciate.
How was it for you becoming a concert pianist, winning the nationwide piano competition at 20 years old?
And most of the time, I think just by recognition and invitation, when people recognize my skills, they invited me to perform and even solo or with a concert and I had several solo, you know, concerts to benefit the concerts and not making profit, basically. But my last one, farewell concert, raised money for my voyage journey to the U.S. to buy airline ticket, because at that time, you know, a lot of foreign students couldn't afford the airline ticket. They had to take a ship, you know, not a cruise ship, okay, cargo ship to come here. Yeah, but I was lucky and I was able to raise money and for my voyage to come to the U.S.
Did you experience any stage fright when you performed?
No, except that fifth grade experience. I told you, my legs were shaky, you know, and when I was leading the national anthem, and my mother earlier that was a fifth grade. My mother always recalled that when I was about 8 years old, I was so calm and confident when I was reciting chapter 2 of the book of Luke about Jesus' birth for church's Christmas gathering. So, and everybody, adults, compliment, say, little Esther was not scared at all. No, she was so confident. And I remember my mother, well, we were, like I said, not affluent by all means, but she had to make a velvet red suit for me, top and the pants. And I still remember that beautiful, you know, sets of clothes.
That's great. So how was it balancing being a concert pianist and your undergraduate education?
Just like in high school, you know, it's very demanding, like Taiwan First Girls High School. And my time in college was also divided just among, you know, piano practice, giving piano lessons to earn some extra money. And I love to wear nice clothes and perform, you know, with a nice outfit, you know, evening gown. So I gave piano lessons and also schoolwork. And I remember vividly that I asked myself one day, if I really want to be a concert pianist, when I was unpacking and repacking for the next trip, I just felt tired. That was a sort of pretty enlightening moment, you know, but at that time I was still in college.
Right, so moving on to your graduate education and immigration to the US, when did you move to the US and how and why did it happen?
I came to the US in 1967 as a foreign student after passing the government very rigorous requirements, including passing a TOEFL English exam and receiving a scholarship or assistantship from a US university. If a student could not get or receive financial assistance from an American university, he or she had to pass a very tough government sponsors go abroad examination. At that time, I was still hoping to enter, like I said, a medical school in the US eventually. So with some pre-med school I took during my college. Yet, I only got the isn't that funny? I got assistantship from Northern Illinois University, majoring in education again. Isn't that strange? That's my fate, I guess, my destiny.
How was it for you attending Northern Illinois University for your master's, then Purdue for your PhD, in comparison to a National Taiwan Normal University?
Not much differences regarding the system, but of course, language and the culture were certainly the major obstacles, even up to now. Often joking, I said, well, Kissinger, such a famous scholar or whatever, but he still speak English with the accent. So I'm not ashamed of my accents. I even tried to record a professor's lectures in the classroom. But that didn't work well because it takes too much of time. And then sometimes after you go back to your room, you just still couldn't figure out what's going on.
Did you encounter any other difficulties in transitioning from National Taiwan Normal University to US universities?
The graduate school, graduate studies. At that time in Taiwan, there are not many graduate programs. So you have got to come here to get advanced degrees. And I think a graduate student, I witnessed graduate programs or graduate studies require much higher level of cognitive abilities. And grades are often determined by reports and presentation instead of only taking tests. So oral and written tests are very, very difficult. You can imagine for foreign students. I can hardly say any words, and I could write, but speaking or it's hard.
Did any family members move with you to the U.S.?
No, I was here by myself. But fortunately, I was very lucky that my older sister had been here in the U.S. for 4 years and working at Purdue University as a librarian, while her husband was working on his PhD. So meanwhile, my uncle was Consul General representing ROC Taiwan stationed in Chicago. So I wasn't really that lonely. And that's why I applied for universities located in Indiana and in Illinois.
So after you finished your master's degree, you married Stanton Yao, who was studying his PhD at Purdue, and then later to meet your financial needs. You applied for a doctoral assistantship for a PhD at Purdue. Can you talk about these experiences and what it was like to receive your PhD?
Honestly, I had no desire to pursue a doctorate degree. Even my NIU, Northern Illinois University advisor, and my father encouraged me toward the end of my master's studies. I just want to be a housewife. I just want to stay home, you know, and I like to play house, honestly, even up to now. I like every choice in the household, okay. And so originally, Stanton, then my fiance, told me that he should be able to finish his doctoral PhD a semester after we got married in the summer 1969. But by April, he told me that he had encountered some dissertation problems, which is common, you know, to a lot of students. And so to ensure that we have enough income, and I applied for an assistantship with the College of Education. Again, education. And because they gave me money. And so frankly, I told my advisors, Dr. Phyllis Lowe, that Stanton could not finish up his studies. I mean, he could finish up his study anytime soon. So I need to finish up my part, my course requirements as fast as possible. Then I could take my thesis with me when we leave Purdue University. So she laid out my degree plan quickly, and I immediately began my proposal for the dissertation, and it took 19 hours each semester. In addition to the thesis, I took French from the for the foreign language requirement, to meet the foreign language requirement. At that time, you need to have foreign language, okay? But now it's not required for doctoral studies. But anyway, during the semester of 1969 at the University of Virginia, while Stanton was collecting his data for his dissertation. And since Purdue did not accept the credits earned at the University of Virginia, and I had to take a test to pass the foreign language requirement back to campus. So that's how I tried to manage, finish within 2 years.
What were some other notable memories for you of your graduate education?
Like I said, I finished up my degree within 2 years, basically. So I remember I drank a lot of coffee, okay? And walking around a huge campus in the winter, snowing days and nights was really a challenge. You know, graduate education classes normally held in the evening because for the public school teachers, you know, after school hours. At that time, I also played, I guess more or less for the income, you know, reason, and for the pipe organ for the University Presbyterian Church. So every Sunday after two morning services, I normally usually just totally collapse and I need to take a long afternoon nap. That's what I remember. Yeah.
Did you have any mentors?
Well, no, sadly, and except a Chinese American professor at NIU. She is not really a mentor, but she was a professor of early childhood education. She advised me to take some courses with her because of the newly launched federal Head Start programs. At that time, less than 30% of women working outside the home, and most of the women just had low wage positions, not professional. And she pointed out the upcoming reality is that the knowledge of early childhood education would always or can always apply to my own family as well as for the employment. So basically, I just didn't, besides my advisors, I had no mentor for studies and career and political involvement. And I can share with you maybe more later on, but one day I remember vividly, even after I was teaching at the University of Houston, one day I just cried out. I said, Lord, bitterly, cried out, literally, bitterly. I said, I just don't have anybody to help me, to guide me. Now I have this political decision. I don't know what to do. And so once I was thinking about, you know, to write a book entitled God is My Mentor.
What were some challenges when you moved to the US? Did you experience any culture shock?
Not really, except the language. English is always, you know, English was only required in high school in Taiwan, but not in college. So I needed to continue English studying or self-study during the college years. So I can tell you many funny stories about language barriers if we have time. But initially, I did not feel the cultural gaps. Maybe I think just as a young person or so-called young, and you just are so excited about being a such affluent, beautiful country. You had all kinds of dreams. You don't feel any negative parts of the society of your life. But now, after being in the US for more than 55 years, I have learned more about the serious, very serious cultural differences in many, many areas. Especially now, firsthand information from my Caucasian husband, I came up with the conclusion. I wish I have time to share with the people later on through YouTube or other program that a nation's traits of a nation or characteristics of nation reflected by the characteristics of the people. I can almost mirror my husband's personality, not judgmental, just like the nation of America. It's so funny, like I can write a parallel, just mirror and image of those two areas. That's interesting. I love history, I love sociology, psychology. I have all those backgrounds. I want to integrate them together and to analyze, to understand American society, and which sometimes as a historians, they just look at one domain, one side, sociologists, one side, but not too many people integrate them together and to understand the true America and true Americans.
Did you experience any racism in school, in the workplace, or in the community in general?
Not in schools, but back to the 60s and 70s, the racism was more targeting the Black, not Asians. We're so few, you know. If you know the history, you know, since 1882, the Exclusion Act against the Chinese immigrants. So basically, there's no legal immigrants from China for almost 80 years. So when people see your Asian face, it's pretty exotic sometimes. People are just excited. So they're very nice and helpful, even though that's they do have stereotypes of Chinese, you know, that's inevitable. But personally, I experienced more sexism than racism during the job hunting in spring 1971. And later in the workplace, both racism and sexism became more subtle. I think mainly because of the competitions.
Okay, I think we'll get more into that when we move into some career questions. But for yes. Now, what was your first job after completing your PhD?
I didn't work full-time after I learned my PhD because I always want to be a housewife, you know, and for 4 years because I just enjoy my housewife at the playhouse, you know. I didn't intend to pursue my PhD, but later on, I can tell you why it changed my original interest to playhouse. Okay.
When did you move to Houston and become an assistant professor with University of Houston, Clear City?
Stanton and I both finished our PhD in June 1971, but he couldn't find a job until February 72 with Lockheed Martin in Johnson Space Center, Clear Lake, Houston. So at that time, our first daughter was less than 3 months old. That's in February 1972. And we had no choice except accepting the offer. So that's why we ended up in Houston.
How was it for you being a housewife and mother to two daughters and becoming a professor?
Well, like I say, I just love to be a mother and a housewife. And I've been there, to play that role for more than 3 years. But the demise of my father inspired me to launch a career. It's a long, sad story. Certainly, it has changed my entire life. And consequently, I was named Outstanding Young Woman and received the Presidential Achievement Award from President Reagan within years. And maybe I can elaborate a little bit about my father's expectation. Like I said, he was a very open-minded father. And he expect girls just like boys. I'm sorry.
No, it's okay. Take your time.
And he encouraged me to work on my PhD. I didn't obey him initially, but I finished. And I stay home. And after he retired, the 3 years after I stay home, and he can visit us. And he said, why don't you work? I said, no, I'm happy with the two kids. And I enjoy my life being a housewife. And he said, you're wasting your talent. After that, just 2 months later, he passed away. So I started looking for a job. And I got it. That's it.
Thank you so much for sharing that moving story with your father.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
How was it for you moving to and living in Houston?
And we just, like I said, we moved in the spring of 1972. Then I became, you know, I look for a job. My father passed away, I look for a job. So in retrospect, I was so mad with God. I said, my father was only 63, short after he's retired. And I said, it's not fair. He didn't even enjoy his life. And here, you know, he's gone. And I was just like a psychologist said, you are angry or denial. So I was angry with God. But now it took me so many years to realize his death, his demise has a purpose in my life.
So 4 years after becoming an assistant professor, you became a tenured associate professor. And then in 1992, you resigned due to government appointments. Can you talk a little bit about these government appointments that led to your resignation? And how was the transition from professor to full-time government political work?
Yeah, usually professorship requires, as you know, to focus on concentrate a certain area as an expert. And the more prestigious universities expect more concentration, professors' concentration in a very narrow field. However, my academic path just did not shape me as an expert, even though I tried. And for various reasons or incidents or events, my teaching responsibility or assignments often present unexpected challenges and led me to a broader scope of academic activities. For example, when I first hired by Clear Lake as an assistant professor, you know what? They asked me to teach elementary school teaching methods, which I had no training for, you know, and I had no knowledge about elementary school in the US. And because of the enrollment increase, so they couldn't find a professor. So they said, okay, why don't you just team teach with another professor? You have it, the second section, she has the first section, she has a textbook, hand out, everything ready. You just, you know, follow her. So I basically was interns or apprentices, just follow her. So I learned about elementary education that helped my children and helped my future career. And also I was led to multicultural education, which also I didn't expect. And the department chair was teaching multicultural education. She was a Hispanic professor, but she later got cancer. So no one could take over. So she asked me, just because of my face, I think, my ethnic background. So she said, why don't you teach multicultural, you know, take over my course, acculturation through education. I think every education major has to, graduate student had to take that. So I did. But because of that, I had to go through all the collections of different ethnic groups. I study all the minorities in the US, their history, their political, their social issues, everything. So that's why I learned so much about American politics, American racial discrimination, the slavery and everything. So I became more like a generalist with a very broad scope of teaching and research experiences, which is not my choice. But again, it's just what happened shaping my career path. And in addition, honestly, I prefer to see the visible impact of my efforts when you serve as a government work or position, either in a long-term or short-term. And the researchers, I don't mean to downgrade the professors. You are in an ivory tower, you expect some come later, some people will find the significance of your research, I mean, especially in humanity or social science. Now, like the chips development, you can have immediate impact in industry or in national security, but not in our field. So I like to see immediate impact on people or changes in our society.
So you've been devoted to serving people throughout your life, establishing, organizing, and participating in many political community organizations. Can you tell us about your work for the Organization of Chinese Americans and the Organization of Chinese American Women in Houston?
Yes, and could I add to go back a little bit? It just dawned on me, you know, and back to the professorship. And we often work along in a small group or team, you know, but on the contrary, the government appointment requires more managerial skills for much larger group or constituents and the budgets. And okay, now I'm answering your question. I'm sorry. Okay. For the organization. Okay. And like I said, as a child, I always fighting for fairness, justice, okay? Even with the boys, I was not afraid of them. And during 1970s, and especially 79, when Jimmy Carter recognized Red China, mainland China, but most of us, the students or immigrants, new immigrants came from Taiwan, Republic of China. So a lot of people went on the street to protest. But like I said, as a professor of multicultural education, I fully understood the importance of the political muscle of minorities and immigrants as related to their motherland. I learned of the successful political involvement of the Jewish Americans. You know, so I contacted the OCA, Organization of Chinese American, with its headquarters in Washington, D.C., and established the Houston chapter. I asked an American-born Chinese, Mr. William Durbin, a NASA employee, to serve as the first president. Later, I was also recruited by OCAW, their women group, for forming a Houston chapter. And the formation of both chapters is fully documented, I think, in your library, Foundry Library, as well as on the FNPL political website. And so you can have a complete minutes, agenda, everything for those two organizations.
Thank you for that. So what are you proudest of in your long career of political community organizing?
Well, I know it's not easy for me to answer and for people probably to understand the whole picture, but I would say probably the impact, the result and impact of my congressional race. Although I lost by a narrow margin with my congressional campaign in 1992 in Houston, but I have inspired and boosted many other Asian Americans' confidence in their potential political endeavors. I was proud of my fight, so-called, unquote, okay, quote unquote, and pleased with the impact in the following years because many Chinese American community leaders who took part in my campaign and the fundraising efforts became involved in partisan politics and made a great stride. They finally realized that was possible to run and even to win an election. And prior to my campaign, there were only four Asian American congressmen, including those in Hawaii, which had very unique political environment. Among those four, there were Japanese Americans from California and India. But Japanese participation has their own history. Well, that's not the scope of today's discussion, but people can Google that, what they experienced during World War II, okay. But after 1993, a total of 16 Pacific Asian, Pacific American congressperson were elected. That's a wonderful record. In addition, there are quite a few APA public office holders throughout the US. In the year of 2020, there were 12 Asian Pacific American running for statewide office in Texas. I mean, in Texas only. In the state of Texas, a Houston immigrant lawyer, you probably know that, Gordon Guo, later was elected to the city council in 1999, and he became, you know, the at-large council member and also Houston mayor pro tem in 2002. And also Dr. Martha Wang was also elected to the Texas House of Representatives in 2002. And recently, the eighth term state senator, Mrs. Angie Chan Barton from Dallas, also recognized my inspiration to her political pursuit at her November 2021 fundraising event in Houston. So as I predicted and promised during my campaign, you know, it did have the ripple effect in the political arena. Possibly those lessons, my lessons, paved the road for those two future American Houston Council persons and one Texas state representative. They are American born, of course, no language barrier. At the national level, Chinese Americans are no longer solely exploited by the Democratic Party, and now also recognized by the Republican Party. In 2000, Republican President Bush had appointed one Chinese and one Japanese American cabinet member, as you know, Elaine Chao and Secretary Norma Minetta, who just passed recently. But previous administration, no such appointment, even now. We don't have anybody appointed by Democrat at the cabinet levels. And I was the first full-time, and also again, I was the first full-time salary Asian American campaign staff ever appointed by a presidential campaign headquarters, besides my own congressional campaign. So I believe it was a good opportunity for me to mobilize and encourage Asian Pacific Americans for, at that time, President Bush Quayle's re-election. And previously, no other presidential campaign ever had a paid staff in charge of Asian Pacific American voting affairs. I was the first one. And in 1988, Cindy Dobb, the Korean wife of a congressman, oversaw the Asian Pacific American voters as a volunteer only. Okay.
When did you return to teaching in higher education, and why did you decide to return?
Oh, the political climate, you know, changed, and no more political appointment. And in 1992, after Clinton won the election, I was told by Democrats, say, there's no R people here, they're all D. That means that you Republican, get out of here, okay? And my tenure position at the UH clinic was filled with another person. And again, I was hoping to resume my full-time housewife with an empty nester in Houston. It didn't work out. Without the third party's involvement, my nearly 30-year marriage ended. And for financial reasons, needs, I started searching for university positions around the whole world, including New Zealand, I remember. And thank God's mercy, I was able to return to the higher ed and move up to the position beyond my own expectation and imagination.
So you were department chair of education at DePauw University and then the dean of the graduate school at Troy University-Montgomery until your retirement in 2006. What were some highlights of your career in higher education?
Well, I was proud to be appointed by President Bush to the Fulbright Scholarship Board, serve on the Teacher Education Committee of Indiana Professional Standard Board, and I was an board examiner of National Council for Accreditation of Teacher Education, which is NK. A lot of people is familiar with that in the educational circle. And it's a very prestigious entity or authority to ensure the quality of all US teacher education programs. And I was named outstanding alumni by my two alma maters. And also I remember my Fulbright trip to visit India's 13 cities in 1986, which helped me a lot because at that time I knew we will have lots of immigrants from India.
Throughout your teaching and mentoring experience, what do you think is the guidance most needed by students?
I think critical thinking, especially now with today's bombarded with fake news, misinformation, and also work ethics. I think at all level, and also the corruptions is incredible. We often criticize the third world countries, but we are one of them.
During your time at these universities, you served the public in a number of appointments, including being appointed by Governor Mike Huckabee of Arkansas to serve on the Early Childhood Education Commission, and then later serving on the National Advisory Committee on Violence Against Women in the U.S. Department of Justice. So I'd like to ask, what were some defining moments for you during these public appointments?
I would say, okay, let me just go back to the earlier time, you know, for the Houston local and the police advisory committee and the mayor's advisory committee that laid the foundation for a lot of later Asian Pacific leaders like Helen Chen's visibility and the influence in the mayor's office. And and at the state, the Texas Asian Republican Caucus, which later became, you know, Texas Asian Assembly, also had a great influence. And also, I was appointed by Governor Willing Clements, to serve on the Board of Pardons and Parole Board. And like I said, for some reason, I'm always fighting for unfairness or fighting for justice. So even though it's not my academic expertise, but I'm always got into that area for some reason. It's a very interesting, you know, path. But at the national level, in my 1992, of course, congressional campaign, and Bush Quayle as a campaign staff set a record of Asian Pacific American delegation and alternates at the GOP, National GOP Convention. And after I helped the campaign in Washington, D.C., I was thinking, you know, to write a book about dirty American politics. But I decided I better not complain too much for security, safety reason, even though it's in America, okay.
How did you become involved in the GOP, like being recruited into Reagan's re-election campaign?
Oh, I'm sorry. I also forgot to add one thing, you know, I'm sorry. And, I talk about local, state, national level, but for my own self, international studies and of the immigration committee, which is sub-cabinet level, and gave me the opportunity to meet the heads of states and worldwide leaders. And so that helped a lot. And also my official trips to Russia, South Africa, by invitation, and Korea actually, and all broadened my knowledge of international affairs. So those things, like I said, I'm not an expert in anything, but I'm a journalist. Okay, I'm sorry. Your next question, you asked me to become involved?
In the GOP.
Oh, in the GOP, okay. That's a very interesting, you know, story, because it's a little bit ironic, I have to say. And recognizing my leadership through Organization of Chinese American and Chinese American Women involvement, a lady named Ms. Esther Key, a Chinese American volunteer of the National Democrat Committee, contacted me in February 1980. And Ms. Key was trying to recruit me to support President Carter's re-election. Initially, I was so flattered and excited by such an offer to become an appointed and super, what they call is a super delegate to the National Democratic Convention. I took the offer and my decision seriously. To make sure that the philosophy of the Democratic Party was consistent with mine, I went to the university library to study the platform of both the Democrat and Republican parties. At the end, I realized that the Democrat Party is not the one for me. So I decided to take part in the Republican Party from ground zero without any connection and knowledge. So basically, the Democrat recruited me to the Republican Party, it says, right? So one day, but I had no channel, no way, okay, no connection. So one day I learned from the local newspaper that the Bay Area Republican Women's Club was going to have a meeting, and the contact person is Vicky Hapke. So I called Vicky, who quickly paid a home visit, you know, with a lot of books about the philosophy of the party and the party leaders like President Reagan's supply side economy and by Jack Kemp and so forth. She immediately recruited me and led me to the Reagan re-election campaign. Since then, Vicky had become my political mentor for a short period of time until she relocated to another state. All my GOP involvement in a chronological order, again, can be found in your library, Foundling Library, and also FNPL website.
So you were elected as a delegate to the senatorial district number 11 convention and the state convention after 2 years of active involvement in the Republican Party in 1982. How was it for you being elected into this position?
It's a learning, you know, process. Everything is new to me. And serving on a resolution committee, which is a policy making committee at the state level, because recent Supreme Court decision on abortion. So that reminds me of my experience back then. And I remember serving on the committee, and there was an issue about abortion. And I was for the decision resolution. Women could have legal abortion under three conditions, you know, mother's life in danger, and victim of rapes and incest. But I lost. My committee decided to have absolutely no abortion allowed. So, but the process is very interesting. You can have a minority report. So I was more or less the lone speaker, okay? So I was the minority. So at the convention, they presented the committee's decision. Of course, majority say no abortion, period. But here's a minority report from Dr. Esther Lee Yao. So I went up to the stage. So I say, my position is under those three conditions, exceptions. The reason, and I start elaborating. And I say, think about if your daughter or your wife been raped, you know. And then I was stopped right away, because that's against the rule. as a minority report or any report, you just report the result. You don't have to elaborate the rationale, explain. So they say, Esther, you don't need to explain. You cannot explain. You just get down, basically. So that's a good lesson. But you know what? They did include those three conditions because my thought, I don't know, solely because of my thought, maybe they had better mind. They did think after I point out, say, how about your wife, your daughters, you know, and in that situation. I didn't finish up the whole story because I was stopped, but I think they got the point. So they adopt that resolution back to 1984.
So you noted that at this time you were also involved in the Asian Republican groups at the national level. Can you talk about these groups and what were some of these groups and what were some of the goals and policies that they were advocating for?
Well, I don't mean to be critical, but I would say a lot of people have different motives when they are involved in political, especially even volunteers, okay? Of course, now it's purely visible. You can see why people get involved in a congressional campaign, money, corruption, all the benefits. And but even back to that, the immigrants, they still think they can, you know, increase, enhance their status, social standing in the US. Not really much in the US, but in the US, Asian community or Chinese community, or back to Taiwan. So most of the organization, just a nutshell, not solid, just a title on their business card and showing, you know, I'm Asian Republican Federation or national organization president or treasurer or board member. So no grassroots at the local or connection to the mainstream political network at all. That's why we had a terrible experience in the 1984 National Convention, GOP Convention. And also that prompted me to organize the Asian Pacific American groups differently.
So you began to form the Texas Asian American Republican Caucus directly under the state GOP, but that it was challenging to form an Asian Pacific American GOP group due to ethnic cultural diversity. Can you talk about these challenges that you faced in making an Asian Pacific American GOP group?
Yeah, as you know, Asian groups are very diverse. This was the first year of the Asian, 1987 was the first year Asian, Texas Asian American Caucus with a new officer elected in December 27, 1986. Unfortunately, this newly elected group did not grow well under the first chairman as expected. And so there's very little information about this group for 1 year, for the year of 87. By the end of 87, new officers were elected and I was elected as the chair and Dr. Y.T. Wong of Dallas as the co-chair. And my top priority was to set up the challenge, to set up, to develop the newly formed group as rapidly as possible and encourage the members to become involved, not only at the local and the state level, but also national level with really records, not just talking, okay. Following my election, I sent out a memo to executive committee members and the chairman of each chapter on November 24th, 87 to outline the goals and the task for the upcoming presidential election, 1988, because normally immigrants are more interested in the presidential election than the local election. You know? So I helped those chapters to get organized. And at the national level, I was involved at the National Republican Asian Assembly's inaugural conference held in Arlington, Virginia from June 14 to 1587. I was a member of the banquet committee and tried to invite Asian American Texans to attend, and I even arranged a meeting with the GOP presidential candidates such as Bob Dole, Senator Bob Dole, and the Republican National Committee and RNC staff for them. And I look at for opportunities for Asian Americans, Asian American Texans for political appointments at both in the state, both the state and the national levels. Not just for myself, but all my friends.
So you were appointed by Senator Bob Dole to the Congressional Commission for the Study of International Migration and Cooperative Economic Development. And you were the only Asian American on the commission and one of two female commissioners. Can you tell us about your work for the commission as well as what it was like to be the only Asian American and one of two women on the commission?
Interesting. For some reason, that's always the case. I was the only female, only Asian. But it didn't bother me. I didn't feel any difference. And only when people pointed out later on, years later. And so I'm proud of being a pioneer. But I have to say, I bear great responsibility, a sense of responsibility or mission to represent Asian Pacific American community and groups. So I always behave, okay? I try, you know, even my dress, my mannerism, my knowledge, I want to win people's solid respect, not as a token appointment. Actually, none of them were a token appointment because there's no such affirmative action for Asian American to serve on any board or committees like other minority groups in the US.
So then did you experience any racism during your political career?
Not really, only until the congressional race, my own campaign. And later on, we can talk about that. And maybe I can talk about my congressional race now, if you allowed, okay? And the background of my campaign, I was hoping to get a better appointment with the Bush's second term. That normally is commemorated with your contribution. And I didn't contribute enough or in the right way because I was helping Senator Dole in the primary. I will explain that if I have chance. Okay, so for the Bush's first term, I didn't get a good appointment. So in the early spring, 1991, while I was serving President Bush at the Department of Education, which is not good for me, I have to say, okay, not good enough for me. So I went to Mr. Ron Kaufman, the political director of Bush's White House, and asked him for his advice about my role in the upcoming re-election of President Bush. I asked him if I should stay in Washington, D.C. campaign for him, for Bush, or return to Houston campaign for Bush. And since Bush was popularity was sky high after victory of Desert Storm, so Ron felt the president will be very safe to be reelected without any problem. But unexpectedly, he pointed out that the Democrat-controlled congressman needed more Republicans to support President Bush's agenda. So he suggested that I ran for Congress in Houston. That was a struggle for me, whether I should take Ron's advice, because I had never thought about running for public office. I prayed and analyzed a lot after meeting him. I even retreated to Holiday Inn in Chevy Chase in Northwest Washington, D.C. to seek God's will and guidance. After consulting my family and a church pastor, I finally decided to run as a calling and a mission in the summer of 1991. I felt it was about a time for Chinese Americans to be visible in the national political arena. Like I said, there are no Chinese congressmen at all, especially in the Republican Party. At the time, there was no Chinese congressman, no representative, nothing, okay? And so most of the Chinese or Asian Americans elected officials at the state level were most likely, or all, I think all, was affiliated with the Democratic Party, including Japanese Americans legislators in Congress. So the purpose of my congressional campaign was not just for personal, not for personal gain at all, interest, not like today. So many people with that kind of agenda, but for Asian Americans as a whole. So my goal was to inspire and galvanize the Asian Americans, particularly the younger generation. Regardless of the outcome of my campaign, I used the analogy of a ladder climbing to symbolize my efforts as the first giant step to reach the political top, regardless of the result. And I was not afraid to lose because I strongly believe that the foundation I laid would lead Asian or Chinese Americans to a higher ground, which you have seen. And there were four political advantages at that time to my candidacy. First is redistricting in Texas after 1990 census added three more congressional seats. Number two, the newly drawn district consists more middle class and the professional voters than before. And number three, the popularity of an incumbent Republican president at that time, Bush, would enhance the victory of a Republican candidate. Number four, the 1992 GOP National Convention held in Houston would provide Republican candidates with more media exposure than usual. So for the four reasons, I decided to take actions. And within weeks, I resigned from U.S. Department of Education position and resumed my teaching at the University of Houston, Clear Lake. But before I left the Department of Education, I was invited by the Clear Lake that summer as their commencement speaker in August. Soon upon my return to Clear Lake, I contacted my friends around the country to organize fundraising events throughout the country in the fall of 1991. Remember, this is nationwide, not just in the state. So you can imagine the impact at the national scale. As a longtime community activist and newspaper weekly columnist with the World Journal with worldwide circulation, I was able to share my message at the fundraising events throughout 14 cities in the US, including New York, Los Angeles, Indianapolis, Phoenix, Chicago, all those, Dallas, and Washington, D.C. And my reputation as a political activist at both the state and the national levels also attracted and motivated many Chinese immigrants. During the campaign, I pointed out the dire need for Chinese Americans to take part in the mainstream politics, based on the historical lessons. Remember, I taught multicultural education and the facts of having representation in the Congress. I shared my conviction to Chinese Americans' political participation and my struggles in the Republican Party with my contributors. I also informed them with a great optimism that I had the support of the Jewish and the Black communities in Houston. Even though they traditionally voted for the Democrats, they felt a minority congresswoman would better represent them than a white Democrat. and pledge their support after primary, because during the primary, they have to vote separately. They don't want to be seen by their friends vote for Republican, you know, candidates. So the challenge for me was to win the primary, and then the minority group in the district would vote for me during the general election, while no separate voting places for Democrats and Republicans. Although I could not guarantee of any victory, I assured my supporters that my campaign will pave the way for future generations. Indeed, my campaign inspired many Chinese Americans who started running for local, state, and federal offices soon after my close call defeat. And those candidates finally realized that it was possible to run and even to win the election. Meanwhile, those Chinese American community leaders who took part in my campaign and fundraising efforts became involved in the politics, in partisan politics, and make a great progress. And in the process, like I said, I returned to from Washington, D.C. back to Houston. And when I came back, our dining room became converted into a volunteer's work area, working area. I hired a leader of young Republicans at UH. He was smart and competent to get the campaign organized, but was soon terminated for dishonesty with the campaign expenses. He was found to use my campaign funds and spend time for his own congressional campaign in a different district. Can you imagine? He later, however, became Congressman Steve Stockman twice, but was convicted on 23 felony counts in 2018. Subsequently, he was sentenced to to serve 10 years in prison, and was ordered to pay more than $1 million in restitution. He was one of the last few people pardoned by President Trump prior to the end of his presidency. After Stockman's waste of my campaign time and resources, my campaign was quickly reorganized by a consultant group from Dallas. They hired a campaign manager, a campaign coordinator, and a secretary. With a local Chinese merchant's generosity, the campaign headquarters moved to one of his empty offices. Although the campaign was well organized and operated by the professional so-called, the price tag was high. My campaign inspired and encouraged many Chinese American volunteers in Houston as well as around the nation, like I said. I want to point out one particular loving great lady. Her name is Esther Shu-Shin Lee of Clear Lake. She worked nearly as a full-time volunteer while my dining room was still constantly filled with the local tireless volunteers. They prepared mailers, various signs, and delivered and placed the yard sign. Later on the eve of the election day, the main street in the I-610 loop, I think you are familiar with that area, were saturated with my street signs. Unfortunately, many of them were removed by some people within hours. My opponent was Dolly Madison McKenna, a white investment banker. She was not a member of any Republican group, did not even live in the district. Her residence in Houston was much shorter than mine. Yet, she had the support of the Little White Republican Women's Club, including the Bay Area Women's Club, which I had contributed greatly my time, resources, and leadership for various campaign functions for years. Obviously, answer your question, racial background became a major factor during a competition. At that time, the Capitol Hill Rose Call magazine in Washington, D.C. pointed out that this congressional primary was unprecedented expensive one in GOP history. At the end, the difference between McCann, my opponent, and me was only around 1,200 votes. Houston Chinese American would have delivered the difference of 600 votes if it divided by 1,200 votes by two, if they had faith and commitment to my campaign. A year later, a native young female before my campaign, a native young female Chinese American ran for Houston Council was only received 6% of the votes. Maybe that's why local Chinese American did not expect that I would make it such close race and felt no need to come out to vote for me if only 6%. But from this close race, many Chinese Americans realized that they should not have underestimated their own candidates and political strengths. And the impact and the result, as I briefly said earlier, is really, I think I'm proud of my fight and pleased with the impact in the following years. And as many Asian congressmen and also many lawmakers and public elected officials around the country from local, state, and national level, including our local Gordon Kwan's as city mayor and Martha Wang and Burton as a state representative. This is all important. Okay, but I also reflect about my election, my campaign. I think that helped other people as well as myself. I'm too late to do it again, but even though my daughter is asked me, right after the defeat, they said, are you going to run again? I said, no way. Okay, but I hope those lessons can also be learned by other people. First, I learned, I overtrust the campaign professionals' advice without trusting my own judgment and listening to my own intuition. Both of my first campaign manager, Steve Stockman, and the subsequent consultants took advantage of my well-funded campaign. Then the campaign strategies adapted by the consultants based on very expensive survey against the immigration might have damaged my candidacy greatly. The sentiments of anti-Japanese imported car and immigration policy were undoubtedly a bad timing to my race as an Asian immigrant. So be careful about the timing, okay? I was portrayed by my opponent as a Japanese immigrant on TV ads. Americans, they don't know the difference between Japanese and Korean and Chinese. And my consultant insists on hiding my Asian face, which is I think it's pretty presentable, but no, you don't show on TV because it's Asian face and no public appearance, only the radio ads. Meanwhile, the consultants use a negative campaign to define my opponent with the tons of mailers. And this tactics was truly against my belief. I'm not that kind of person in the personality. I was only allowed, so-called, to walk with my volunteers in certain prisons and to continue my fundraising, fundraising schedule. That's it. I was leading based on the early absentee voters. I was convinced that the negative campaign and the stale candidacy had a negative impact on voters' decision toward the end. Recently, I was joking with Bill, my husband. I said, if maybe I should have learned from Trump. At that time, I can challenge it. That's stealing my vote because of my absentee early voting. I was winner and they stole my votes, during the election day. They probably sent the wrong people there, but anyway. Obviously, my conservative candidacy was well received initially by the voters until my negative mailers bombarded voters. I should have insisted on my own intuition instead of relied on the well-paid consultants. As I predicted and promised, my campaign did have a ripple effect in the political arena. Possibly those lessons paved the road for two future American City Council, like I said, and also two future cabinet Asian appointees, and which never happened in other administration,
Thank you so much for telling us all that. So I think for the sake of time, we're gonna skip down to the next section of questions. That's okay with you?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. So how did you educate your children, your daughters, as in what were some values that you emphasized in your daughters' upbringing?
I think, basically, my children, I emphasize honesty, integrity, and I encourage them to be independent and also have a self-confidence. Remember, I'm an education major, so I knew how to combine the Western and the Eastern culture traits to raise my children to get the merits of both cultures. So I try to be in the center, instead of just traditional Chinese Americans or Western, type of child rearing techniques. And I provide a very healthy diet, regular life, simple life experience, for music, for all kinds of twirling, cheerleading, everything. And so very diverse experience. I'm proud of them. I taught them piano lessons. I gave them pianists. They won competitions. So at the state and also local level, and play with the symphony orchestra because they're winning, first place, of the competition, concerto contest. Yeah.
What church do you belong to, and how important has religion been in your life?
Well, right now, I don't belong to any church, but I attend a church with my husband, and it's a rural small church. It's not really small, about 200. So it's, pretty good size for the small area.
Mm-hmm. How was it for you establishing the Space City Chinese School in 1972?
Well, the reason I established the Chinese school because I always believe Chinese should be able to speak Chinese. I know that's weird, and that's not updated attitude, but I think if you are Chinese, you better be able to speak Chinese. So even though my daughter was only 3 years old, but I decided to start a Chinese school for the other older children who didn't speak Chinese at all. And also as a Christian, I always want to spread the gospel. So I use that as a channel to channel and share my blessings with those people, with those kids. So we have singing and storytelling, Bible storytelling in Chinese, singing in Chinese, and I started in my apartment, in our two-bedroom apartment for several months until we moved to Sagemont. Then we relocated to Chinese. First, this is something I'm very, very proud of. The first Chinese school in America, weekend Chinese school, because the other Chinese school always held in Chinatown and after school daily, normally daily after school program. But I speak Cantonese, not Mandarin, but this is different. And as a result, you can see the impact. Now we have so many Chinese schools around the country, thousands, thousands. And now my niece and nephews, they are able to speak Chinese fluently, I think because of the work of Chinese schools. So never underestimate a personal small effort and just planting the seeds. And now it's such a big thing, but I can claim proudly that's the first one. And we have a record on that.
Can you tell us about some other non-political community organizations, events, or activities that you've been a part of?
Oh, there are a lot. Okay, how much time we have? I don't know your schedule, you know, but I think it's hard for me to record Women's Voters League in the minority women's group, even though after I returned from DC, during my unemployment time, and I work for AARP, and so I've been involved in musical group, and earlier, along with the Chinese school, we have a parent discussion group to talk about how do we raise kids in a bicultural, bilingual environment back to them. Okay, remember that's about 50 years ago. And in Clear Lake, we have a family discussion group, which is very good. So I'm proud of that too. And and we also started our church, Bible study, and in our home started that laid the foundation for current Clear Lake Chinese school, Clear Lake Chinese church. And I started the Bible study from our house. At that time in Clear Lake, we only have two Christian families, Herbert King and Peggy Herbert King, and Cynthia and Ronald Chan. They're all deceased now. And so we had a bi-weekly Bible study in our house in order to attract the local Chinese Americans. I prepared them sing each time, because at that time, no other places you can find the Chinese them sing except in the Yao's family. So I prepare all kinds of them sing. I can do all the them sings except oil sticks, youtiao. But now I know how to make a youtiao, you know, years later. So a lot of things going on, but like I said, I know we're running out of time. I don't know, you know, your plan or your priority.
Let's continue going through the questions, if that's okay with you.
Yeah, sure.
Perfect. Thank you. So what do you do for relaxation? What have you been doing since your retirement?
Oh, well, yeah, that's a good remark, retirement and before and after, okay? During my work, when I was working, my relaxation is changing tasks. You just switch from one thing to other. When I was exhausted, tired, reading tired, I just do the cooking or swabbing the floor. I never had a helper. That's the promise I gave to Stanton. He said, if you want to work, because he was against for me to work. Even though I told you my father's demise caused me, you know, look for a job. And he said, if you go out and work, then I will divorce you, you know? So under that kind of, yeah, that's kind of the mentality. And so I said, I will not jeopardize, my work will not jeopardize any life you have right now. Your meals, three meals on time, your house will be clean, children be taken care of. You don't have to do any extra. He didn't even know how to change a diaper, okay? So, but at that time, that's the agreement. So I just do it. I did it. And changing task is relaxation for me.
Wow, that's so admirable.
So he said, if you don't you cannot handle it, don't work. Don't have a volunteer. You got to meet your own basic requirement, responsibilities. So, I supervise my children's piano lesson practice every day. After school, I pick them up. They've never been at daycare center. And I try to schedule, you know, as a professor, that's the benefit. I teach 9 hours. I taught 9 hours and I keep 6 hours office hour. So like I said, the graduate school students are mainly in the after school. That means in the evening or late afternoon. So I always take my children to school, pick them up. That's just like normal. For them, I'm not a working mother. I was just like a full-time mother and pick them up and I have a snack and practice piano, study the Chinese and the routine. Yeah. And then I went to school, university to teach in the evening. And if I didn't have evening class, then I work with them until 8 o'clock them to bed. Then I work for another 3 hours or so.
Wow.
That's me. Wow. And never window shopping and cut my own hair even nowadays, yeah? And perm my own hair and cut the whole family's hair, actually. My children hate it, the girls, you know, girls. And but a crew cut haircut is for my, for standard, so no problem.
Okay, so shifting a little bit, the political environment for Asian American women is quite different today compared to the 80s, for instance. What are some of the advantages you would consider that are afforded to younger generations of Asian Americans that did not exist 40 years ago?
Well, you think about, just like I said, cooking, all that, okay? And now you can outsource it. Like my kids say, okay, we got to, the cleaning ladies coming, or the gardener, you know. I said, my goodness, I was the gardener, I was the cleaning lady, everything. And they can have a carry out, they can eat out, and they can have a nanny, you know, and stay with the kids, you know. They can have a lot of advantages. Even though you're not affluent, you still can have a daycare center. At that time, there's no quality daycare center. But luckily, we have the university preschool program and lab school. Remember early childhood education? My professor encouraged me to get into it. So I taught that. I mean, those courses too, you know. So I send my girls to the lab school after they, I mean, when they were eligible, 3 year old, the second one. The older one, of course, was already, you know, in, and I went to private pre-kindergarten and kindergarten. But anyway, so they, now it's so convenient for you. And also you have a maternity leave. I even heard you have a paternity leave. My goodness, you know, I can give you one example. When, remember I told you I was looking for a job in 1971 summer after I got my PhD, or almost got my PhD in the springtime. And then when I went to Harrisburg University, Virginia, for interview, and the department had to say, do you have children? Now it's not supposed to ask, right? During the interview, you don't ask a personal questions. But she did. It's okay. It's legal. So she asked me, do you have children? At that time, I just got pregnant. I was debating. You know, I don't want to lie. So I say, I'm expecting, but it will be during Christmas time, semester break, which is true, about December, beginning of December. You know what? In the beginning, she was so enthusiastic. He says, Stanton doesn't have a job, no problem. We will find a job for him to teach math or what. They don't have engineering, but we will find a job for him. So you both can come. So they really want me, you know, so much. But just because of my pregnancy, she said, no, we cannot hire you. Right up front, she said, because if you Well, first of all, in the wintertime, it's dangerous for a pregnant woman to walk on the ice, you know, whatever, if something happened to you. And number two, if you have a baby before the semester break, I have to take over your courses. We all have to share your course. No way. Isn't that a discrimination? That's what I say. It's not racial discrimination. They didn't reject me because of my Chinese background or my accent, but they reject me because of women.
Wow, yeah, that is discrimination.
And now you have a maternity leave, you got pay leave, you got paternity leave, you have all this benefit. At that time, and my salary at that time, even at UH, I found out I only nearly two-thirds of my male colleagues' salary. So I went to the dean. I said, how come? You know, and he said, because your salary is just supplemental to your family. But this guy, he doesn't have, he's a single actually. Okay, he doesn't have family, but he just by himself, he doesn't need much either. Okay, but then he said, that's the only income he has. You have other income, your husband. Oh, come on, hey, my husband wasn't reliable. If this same guy here, I would say, look, he divorced me because I was unemployed. Just because of that. So, you know.
Wow, these are really stunning stories.
Yeah, so you can see the generation value changes. It's not just the public, I mean, just the employment, but interpersonal relationship. The husband, the colleagues, everything, you know, not just a job, but personal life, everything. So I'm proud of you doing this study to really trace back the social changes in this country, maybe, or in Texas, whatever.
So in what areas do you see the talents and efforts most needed for Asian Americans in public service today?
Excuse me?
So in what areas do you see the talents and efforts most needed for Asian Americans in public service today?
I think it depends on what you're interested in. You know, what do you want to pursue? And I can say in two categories, if you're talking about public services, and one is managerial position, and like administrators. And the other one is like a think tank or strategist. Okay, maybe I can use the example of the White House president, administrator, but Congress is more like a thinkers. So you can see the current president, Biden and Trump, they have two different personality, strength and weaknesses. Biden, maybe he had a lot of thinking, a lot of knowledge as a longtime senator, but he's a not decisive, not make a decision, not able to know how to manage the people, to deal with the people, even communicate with the people. You know? But on the other hand, Trump is a good communicator, whether he's lying or whatever, but he does get his message out, truth or fakes, it doesn't matter. He got communicated, okay? We have to give him the credit. He's decisive of whether it's right or wrong. He did make decision, okay? And so he's from the other, you know, group. So if I'm going to elect a president, I have to consider carefully. I wanted to elect someone who's just have a congressional background or experience, or who has a government experience. I mean, like governor experience. If you look at the American history, you find out great presidents, Roosevelt, two Roosevelts, all came from New York governorship. They all have Reagan, even as an actor, but he has governor experience, administrative experience. So that's the difference. But if you elect, or even Bush, junior Bush or senior. But if you just elect some a senator, you know, hey, it's different. Okay, watch out. And so being a senator is not qualified to be a president, I would say. Okay, they might talk, think, and on the paper, but no delivery, no decision. Okay.
So you've been appointed to government positions where you've noted that you were hoping to apply some of your academic expertise. What do you think may be missing in curriculum currently taught in school about public service?
I think several things. Of course, earlier you mentioned about, I mentioned integrity or honesty, you know, that's important, critical thinking. On top of that, I'd like to point out several C's. Number one is communication. You've got to be able to come on, whether you are, like I say, either president or senator, you've got to be able to talk, come on, hey, okay. And you've got to be able to convey your message, okay, to people. Number two, orally or in a written form, you know, but communication is important. Even though you have an accent, but it's okay, but you have to get your message out, okay. And speaking of that, okay, I remember Senator Doe's wife, Lily Doe, and she made a statement. She said, if you want to speak and convince people, you have to speak with a passion. Remember that. If you have a passion for that group of people, you will be able to deliver your message effectively. I think that's very, very true. You know, if I don't like to talk to you, I don't think I will be so excited. But because I like to talk with you, share my experiences, so I sometimes get overexcited or too, you know, emotional, right? But anyway, so you need to have that kind of passion or compassion. Okay, the first of all, like I said, communication. The second one is connection, which I missed a lot, especially even American-born Chinese or Asians. They need to focus on this, how to establish your connection, networking. Of course, during my era, there's no internet, no LinkedIn, no Google search, no, you have, it's hard to get connected. Okay, you use Rolodex. You probably never heard of that, you know, and index card to write down your friend's phone number. And so now it's very, or now you have social media, so easy for you to get connected, but use it properly. So connection is important, but don't just drop name, you know, anytime you want. Make sure if a dropping name will help you or hurt you. Okay, that will be another lesson. You know, I wish I could talk about that. But anyway, so connection is the second one. And the third one is credential. I don't think Asians will have an issue because we're all very well equipped with our degrees, our academic records, you know. And so I'm not going to elaborate that much, you know. But the other C, I would say, is competence to be able to manage, you know, financially, personnel in a management of resources, people, budget, everything. Sometimes we are so focused on our narrow area, we forgot the bigger picture or the budget, the financial impact, you know, all that. So I think the competence of manage your time, manage your people, manage your team, you know, I remember Colin Powell said, General Colin Powell said that he said the best leader is to simplify the most difficult test is the best leader who can simplify task. If you can make 10 steps into one or two, then you succeed. See, that's a competence. So, and then the other one I would say is compassion, or you got to like your job, like the people you're dealing with. I say, thank God, I always enjoy, I like what I do. Regardless of what I told you, the frustration, the setback, the defeat, but I always enjoy the process. So although my first husband said, you're just wasting your time, you always get lost, you always get defeated. But I said, according to university professor, you submit a grant proposal, you submit six, you can only get one funded. That's the chance. I said, if you go by that chance, I'm not too bad. You got to try. If you don't put that out, you don't get it. Any. So you got to put the six in order to get one. So I think if you go by that ratio, it's not too bad. So my life is not so miserable. Okay. Actually, it's pretty good. Thank God. And I say, you know, you got to have compassion. You got to have a conviction. You have to convict. I mean, you're committed to what you do. You believe. Maybe from childhood, I just believe things should be right. You cannot be wrong. People should keep the justice, should be fair. Yeah, I remember the interview for my appointment in the Department of Education. My boss asked me, what do you think are your strengths? Just one word. I say, my strength, my one word, is, you know, fairness. Fairness. I want to be fair. Okay. Do everything fair. That's me. Okay. And be fair. So maybe that just permeates throughout my years of life. Permeate, I say.
That's all such great advice. Thank you.
So, other questions?
Yes. So you graded your career as B, but A for being a wife and a mother. Have your daughters been inspired by your career in politics and in teaching?
I don't think so. Although they gave me a lot of credit for their Chinese, for their piano. Sometimes I say, do you regret you taking piano? Like sometimes I did regret myself, you know, spend all the time for piano. But they say, no, it helped us to become very self-disciplined. You know, I thought that's good. And of course, later on, say science approved. It's good for other development too, musical, you know, experience. And I didn't mean to make them never want them to be a musician, but they were so talented. They both have a perfect pitch, you know, like the first daughter, before she could talk, when she was only 4 months old, she was able to hear, you know, singing the melody of the Chinese school. We teach the children in the Chinese school because she was sitting there just, you know, waiting for me to teach the kids and sing the song. So she sang the song in her crib. It's amazing. But I didn't push her to be a pianist or musician, you know. And they are very diverse. Like I said, they're cheerleading and do cheerleading, drill team, debating, swimming team, you name it. They are not inspired by, they're proud of me. And my younger daughter, when they made a comment, mother, you're very conservative, but you're very open-minded. I say, how could that be? That's contradictory. Yeah, in the beginning. And she said, no, you're conservative because in terms of value, you're very conservative, you know, integrity, all that, honesty, all that, loyalty, all that. Like a loyalty, you know, I helped the campaign, all the campaign. I fought until the end. I want to bring the gap as narrow as possible. That's me. You know, I don't give it up, loyalty. And but she said, on the other hand, you're very open-minded to new ideas, to people's suggestion, to criticisms. So I said, oh, that's pretty good. No, I never thought about that. I said, that's a good line. But I also have to say one thing which made me cry the other day. I look at one old letter from my daughter, younger daughter. I think she was about 6 years old when I was doing research in Taiwan. See, this is career woman's choice, you know, strategy. I mean, you can say choice or tragedy or whatever you want to call, okay? And I took the older one with me, but I left the younger one with my mother and my husband, you know, as my mother come to help us. So the babysit during the summer, just one summer research project. And so in her note to say, dear Ma, I miss you so much. I wish you don't go. That really hurt me. You know. Oh, she said, first of all, she said, I love you. I miss you so much. I wish you don't go. Isn't that heartbreaking?
Yes. Yeah. That is. That
really yeah. Is. So, but career woman, you had no choice. Like, I remember the first time I presented my speaking of networking, I had a hard time. That's the out of all the C's, I think my most weak part is the connection, networking. First of all, we don't have a background, family background, whatever, okay? No connection to anywhere. And then no professor connection. I have to stay home for 4 years. I lost the contact with my professors, basically. I cannot even find someone to write references for me, okay? And then later on, you know, and speaking of the presentation of papers, I remember the first time I had to present a paper at College Station, Texas A&M. And we have to take the whole family to the meeting. So Stanton took the two girls to the zoo, you know, College Station, the zoo somewhere. And then I dash in to the meeting place and did my presentation and dash out meeting them, you know, at the zoo. See, that's the life. And they came back. How could you do the networking that way? Again, that's the difference for women at that time. Yeah. And no support system. Yeah. And or childcare or whatever. Your spouse, first of all, is very traditional.
Yeah. Thank you for sharing all that. So what's your view of US policies on immigration in recent years and their impacts on Asian immigrants?
I think basically there are two areas you can address the immigration policies, because I serve on the commission and before, we all knew actually, it's well known fact, it's because of the economic reason or political unrest in those countries. So people came, including myself. We want to have a better life to come to the US for American dream. Or even today's immigrants from any other countries. It's for better life, that's the bottom line. But to what extent you mean better, okay? But for those from southern borders, they needed to escape death, hunger, economic hardship, and just life-threatening situations sometimes. And we have a plenty of land. And if you go back to the history and the West, California, Nevada, all those states, Texas, used to belong to who? Do you know? Mexico. We conquered it. We took it, right? That's their land. Whose land? It's not my land. It's their land. And it's still not very dense. we can accommodate those people, but the issue, the challenge is how do you manage? Okay, you have to have a good system. Now with the internet, with the high tech, you can easily monitor who are here, who are not here, who just want to work. Basically, they just work. If just like earlier Chinese immigrants who came to San Francisco for making a living and send the money back home, that's fine, let them do that, okay? And so they're just a migrant worker. We need a cheaper lettuce, cheaper produce there, okay? And let them work, but let them send money back and coming back and forth freely. As long as we know where are they, whether they pay tax, whether they do their shares, whether they fulfill their obligations, that's fine. That's our job, our government's job, to put in a very effective management. So I think a management and is the key. Then we can both be beneficial. It's for mutual beneficial benefit. For example, like I said, we got a cheaper labor. We got a better, harder worker. You know why America is so great? Because the infusion of immigration, migration. Because when you have new immigrants coming, every 5-10 years, once in a while, that stimulates competition. The local people have to work harder, although they resent. Now, they resent the Chinese work hard, scientists in Silicon Valley. They resent Indians from India work hard, but they have to work hard. They cannot totally relax a little bit, you know, maybe not, maybe just a little bit, not much. So that's the infusion of blood, basically, the new immigrants. But if we stopped it, totally stopped it, my goodness, we commit our own suicide. Okay, so I don't think that's a good policy. And just very briefly, but speaking of the Asians, yes, we are in danger. Like I said, the competition, even my own experience. When you're in the bottom of the totem pole, you know, like a pyramid, you know, there's so many people, they don't care. If you're assistant professor, your instructor, they don't care. But once you try to lead it to the top, lead them, forget it. The competition will get tougher, okay? That's the reality, that's in all the field. So we have to be prepared for that. How? That's the challenge. Do we have time to talk about that?
I think we're running out of time.
Yeah, that's true. That's what I thought. Maybe in the future, you know, I will talk about how we can overcome that. But Indians are doing a much better job than we are because of their cultural background.
Right. Okay. So next question, how would you describe the Asian American community in Houston?
I think they have been doing great job and I'm proud of their accomplishment since 1960s. And but I think they still have room for improvement because of like I say, the threat of racism. And they needed to promote a better understanding between Chinese culture or Asian culture and the non-Asian culture groups. And cross-cultural understanding is very important. And so you've got to be able to do that and take all the opportunities to communicate with your neighbors, especially those people living in a high-end neighborhood, elite neighborhood. You got to keep a good relationship with them. Even, you know, take an extra step. I'm sorry to say that, but that's basically all we need to do. Try to do everything like I did back to 1980s, 70s, 80s, I'm sorry. I started the campus, you know, Nuna Festival celebration, Nuna New Year celebration to promote Chinese culture, to introduce Chinese culture to local people. So I think that's important.
How would you like to be remembered?
I like it to be remembered as a pioneer, you know, in many areas. I was the first in many, many areas. And I also like to remember to be a community activist, not just a political appointee, that means nothing, but really concern the interest of the people, the activist for the benefit of the people here. And also, you know, not just in the local level, but national level. I know we have a lot of appointees at a higher level and a lot of lawmakers, but they are only at one level, either state or city or what. But I have been experienced many, many different levels. So I think that gave me a broader view of the structure of the United States. I think also I'm a ladder climber, and I laid the foundation for the first step. I laid a foundation for people, and I pulled people up to a higher steps. I never stop other people's move ahead of me. I can tell you many stories, but I don't want to. I don't have time here, you know, how, you know, and people cannot deny, you know, and how I help them, you know, to where they are.
So you've been advocating for Asian Americans throughout your life. What do you think about the rise of anti-Asian racism during the pandemic? And do you have any advice for Asian Americans today trying to combat anti-Asian sentiments?
Asian?
Do you have any advice for Asian Americans today trying to combat anti-Asian sentiments?
Yeah, okay, yeah, sure, yeah. Like I said, besides to promote the cross-cultural understanding, and also you have to modify your behavior too, yeah? And of course, like your generation, you speak a perfect English and perfect communication skill, but the culture is very subtle, okay? And you have to modify. I'm not saying you have to abandon your cultural heritages, but you have to modify it. You know, for example, I'm learning too, okay? Let me just give you one verse. Okay, let's talk about a big picture. Like the Indians from India, they're doing much better. They're in a managerial position more than we do. Why? The Google, Microsoft CEO, all Indians, not Chinese. Why? Because of course they speak English well. And also, not just English well, but also their mentality. They used to be dealing with a lot of British Westerners. Then they learned how to deal with them for generations. They know how to play the game. They knew how to manipulate. They knew what they want. They knew what all that. They know what they're thinking. We don't. We have to learn that part. I'm still learning. That's what in the beginning I said. Now I learned, I found out more and more cultural differences after 55 years. Let me give you one simple example. Happened recently. And I gave a gift to a relative, a little bit bigger than usual because special occasion. And he returned back. He said, that's too much. And, but Bill, if you ask Bill will say, I love to accept whatever you give to me, the more the better, okay? They will not question. But we Chinese say, no, it's too much. We decline. When you decline, how do I feel? I feel like I've been rejected. Okay, the gift I gave you, you say too much, you rejected. I don't want to speculate what you think, whatever reason, but you were not happy, you rejected. That's not a good idea. But I can understand traditionally, I probably do the same thing. I don't return, but I always say, oh, I don't want that. I thank you, say, I don't want that, I don't need that. But Bill always say, accept it with a great pleasure, because people are happy when you accept their gift, you know? So I learned to accept. He said, learn to accept and don't worry about return. That's the reason. Chinese always worry about to return the favor. Okay, if I got this big gift, how do I return next time? So I better return this to you. I don't want to accept it, but I got the rejection. That's no good. That's the difference between Western culture, or Western, Eastern, I mean, Chinese and American culture. Do you agree with me?
Yeah.
That's very common, right? Mm-hmm. Another thing, maybe it's getting better, is interrogation. When you first met someone socially, okay, as of course a Caucasian, oh, how many kids you have? Oh, where do you live? And not what your school your children go? Maybe it's for competition, maybe for reference, or maybe just for reference. Oh, what school are your children going? Which is the best school? Are they going to the best school here? None of your business. When I taught multicultural, that's the problem. That's why I became more sensitive to those issues. We had a class called cross-cultural understanding or exercise, assimilation, you know, exercise to teach you verbal, nonverbal, all these skills. How do you deal with that? Okay. And you just very naturally, you didn't know you make a mistake. You think, okay, I just caring about you. I just try to find a reference for my children. No, this is not acceptable. Like, okay, you find a friend moving to a new home. Oh, how much is that house in that neighborhood? Then the American Caucasian, if they are nice, they say, oh, too much to offer. If they're ugly, none of your business. You ruin the reputation, I mean, relationship. That's why you don't get promoted. That's why you don't get into their society. I think some people wonder, how come you get into the political arena? So many experiences. I'm not saying achievement, but so many experiences. Because I probably know their culture better than a lot of Chinese Americans because of my multicultural studies. And I have to tell you, Karen, when I was asked to teach multicultural studies, I studied all the culture. I didn't know Chinese Americans' immigration history until I studied it. I didn't know. I had no clue because that's irrelevant to me. Okay, even though I went to Chinatown for grocery, it doesn't matter, okay? And then after I realized how Chinese people, overseas Chinese, were treated around the world, including in San Francisco, New York. And I cried while I was studying. I said, Lord, I have been sheltered. I've been protected all these years. I was happy to be a housewife, to have American dream, and then to be an assistant professor, or maybe it would be associate professor. But why you want me to study these ugly chapters? Now I understand why. See, everything has a purpose. Everything has a reason. Now you probably learned from my story. Every time I turn right, God led me to the left. And I left, and God led me to the right. And I remember when I was in 30s, in the 30s, a reporter came up to me, you know, curious about my career and the achievement. They said, how do you set up your career goals? I said, never. Because every time I try to set up, it's always the opposite direction. You saw that from today's interview. How many opposite direction? I have gone through. But everyone just turned out better. I love it. Don't you think so?
Yes. It's so great to learn about your life.
Yeah, I'm still learning. And people ask me, what's the difference between married to a Chinese and an American husband? I said, I don't want to be judgmental, but I think one thing I learned is about me. I spend more time to get to know this guy. So sometimes my husband said, I said, I know you. Then he will complete a sentence from Adam. I said, right. Because I often told him, I said, I know you from Adam. You know, as a psychologist, a psychology professor, you know, all child development professor, all the areas, I can't tell people's motives. I can't tell what they are going to do next. That's why my children don't like me. Mother, you always can read our heart, our mind. We hate it. Okay. I have to prevent them from making trouble for me. Right? And now I have more time and also to reflect on myself to improve my communication skills. Very simple reason. Take the trash out, husband's job sometime. If old me, I would say, okay, Stanton, would you please take the trash out? Okay, or will you pick up tomorrow? You know what I would say today? And this one with two bills, I will not be so commanding or demanding. It's just a gentle reminder, tomorrow is a trash pickup day. Same thing, right? He will do it. Nobody wants to be told what to do. Even you, me, anybody. So you just have to remind them, you got your choice. If he doesn't do it, then you will find out. Okay, instead of saying, have you taken out? I remind you. Why don't you just take a look outside? Why are you asking? My old me would say, have you taken out? Hey, now I just look at. See, I'm learning, lifelong learning. Do you agree with me?
Yes.
You don't have to include it if this is too long, but I think it's fun to talk about that.
Yeah, no, it's all good.
Yeah, yeah, so, even though for older people, I will be interviewed by another program next week. And a week from today. And the moderator, the interviewer told me, oh, you have so much, it's good. You have so much information for us to interview. But also it's tough. We don't know how to get started. I think you probably have the same, you know, challenge too, you know. And but the bottom line is, you just have to learn all the time, improve yourself, and don't complain, don't point it to other people, don't blame other people. Be responsible for your own action. That's another good skill for leadership. But we don't have that. Everybody, that's another culture trait. Chinese always blame ourselves. Oh, I didn't do it right. I failed the test because I didn't study hard. Americans say, oh, because the test that the professor gave me is too tough. That's what my students always told me. I didn't fail. Your question is not fair. It's not clear. Yeah, blah, 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 blah. It's always blame others. Chinese is different. So when you deal with the Chinese or deal with your parents or with your colleagues, Caucasian colleagues, you need to play double face Eva, I call, or woman. At home, with your Asian folks, you do one thing. With the other people, you do other thing. So that makes you like bilingual, bicultural, or multicultural. Now you got to be at least a bicultural or multicultural in order to succeed. My younger daughter is executive of a huge Fortune 200 company. And she's stationed in London. She decided to now return to US, okay? Even though she might have to give up her job. And for that business assignment, she said she did a lot of study on anthropology, on British culture. So she could work with their parliament leaders, their mentality. See, that's what we need to. I didn't intend to include this part. It just dawned on me, her effort. I admire her effort. I said, you did study. Yeah, she said, there are several books. If you want to read, you can read. I said, no, thank you. I'm over it. Yeah. And so how to deal with the Brits, she has to learn. And by the way, she speaks Chinese, Russian, and Spanish, of course, English.
All right, let's move on to the next question.
You still have a question? Okay, good.
Two more left.
Okay, no problem.
What are your hopes for the for Asian American communities in the US?
Oh, I didn't complete it well. And I said, you know, we should integrate more. And one painful point, I hope I will not offend any one of the people who is going to watch this program or this recording. Based on the theory of a very famous sociology, Milton Gordon, about immigrants' assimilation and in the US, this is a reality. This is Esther's thinking. And he laid out how could a minority be accepted by the majority? Or why the discrimination happened? The major cause of discrimination is your skin color. I know this is very sensitive, but we all know, even among the Blacks, the lighter Blacks discriminate against the darker Blacks. Okay. So, which leads to my position about my children's marriage when they were young, or my comment to some parents, which a lot of them were upset with me. I say, I'm not against interracial marriage. In fact, I promote that. I say, then you will lose your identity, racial identity, physical characteristics. You will become more accepted. I'm sorry, that's reality. Okay, and people will not discriminate you because they couldn't tell you're Chinese or not. That's the easiest way, probably. And also, by the way, I have to tell you, here comes my political involvement. When Bush lost his re-election, all the Asian Pacific American appointees got together for a party, like a farewell party. We all got together with the spouses, okay, in Washington, D.C. You know what I found out? When I look around, all those political appointees, I was the only one married to a Chinese, my own racial group. the woman they married to Caucasian men, the man married to Caucasian woman. Does that tell you something? I sometimes wonder if I would have married to Bill when I was young, I think my life would be totally different. Because I knew more about American culture. He can correct me a lot of things. It's not bad or good. Like the gift giving, like I say, whether you give too much or you, whether you have to return or whatever. It's not good and bad. It's just a custom. Whether you ask nosy or caring, it's not good and bad. It just causes misunderstanding, right? So it's not bad to have an interracial marriage. That's a proved occasion. I saw that. I was shocked. Of course, a lot of people don't pay attention, but sometimes I'm more observant. Okay. So I said, my goodness. So.
Thank you for talking about these difficult but important points.
I know it's controversial.
It's good to have this dialogue, though.
Yeah.
Okay, so last question.
Do you have
any other advice for future generations, young Asian Americans who are interested in becoming government officials or pursuing leadership roles?
Okay. I said that those are several C's. I can read. Repeat it, you know, communication, competence, credentials, connections, and compassions or convictions. I had all, although not good, not all 100%, but yeah, some pretty good. But my worst part is the connection. So build up the connection. Okay. And of course, characters too. Okay, integrity, I said that repeatedly. But another thing, which is not C, but very, very important after 40, 50 years nowadays, money talks. You got to earn money. If you look at today's our society, the rich get richer, whether you like or not. The powerful get more powerful because they all hang together, connected together. Let me just give you one example. If I have a congressman, if I'm running for Congress, I don't have enough money, but the other one had a better connection, more money, raise more money. Just like my own congressional race, that investment banker. She defeated me. And now it's even worse because when I get into the Congress, if I got into the Congress, I will build up more connection, more rich people around me. I can raise more money and nobody can defeat me because I have more money, even though I'm very corrupt. Then I'd be used by those donors. I'm thinking about their interest above all the average voters in my district. See, that's not fair, but that's a reality. What's the solution? Turn limitation. Is that possible? No. Because who makes the turn limitation? Nobody. You think a congressman will vote for that? No. They vote them out. So we just perpetuate the bad system. I don't know. I'm just glad I'm getting out of this business. I'm politically, I'm out, you know? And I actually a couple years ago, I was thinking to run for office. I was so mad with the ignorance of the people and I said, I don't need to win, but I want to voice my concerns, my positions, you know, like a term limits, limitation. But then I said, why I have to do that? I will invite hostility. I will, now with the gun problem, people probably come to my house with the guns, with the threats, death threat. Why I want to do that? I'm more concerned about my safety than the righteousness or justice. That's sad. I'm chicken, I'm sorry, you know. Okay? And not just myself, but my husband, right? Why I put my husband in danger? If I get shoot, you know, in the supermarket, people don't like my position, that's fine. How about my husband? If somebody broke the house, okay, or empty, right? So it's a big mess, but hopefully people will be able to resolve it. I don't know. We better conclude with a positive note, okay? And but the beauty is being a bicultural, bilingual, you have a lot of advantages. You will see things differently. You will be more open-minded, just like my girls. You know, they see things differently. And they also, you know, be more global-minded and more tolerant to people. And so at the same time, they will enjoy life more. Yeah, not so provincial. And so like we say, you know, like the frog in the bottom of the well, okay, in Chinese saying. And so I think being multicultural, bicultural are good. So don't give up. And even though I have no objection about interracial marriage, but I still encourage people to keep their own heritage, especially language. Language is hard to learn, to acquire after puberty. We all knew that. But when you're young, it's easy to pick up. Like my children, we spoke Chinese at home. They have no accent. They're Chinese. Although they have now they lost a lot of vocabulary, but still no accent.
I think that's a really wonderful way to end this interview. Thank you so much, Dr. Shu-Shin Lee, for sitting in for this long interview with me.
Well, it's a great pleasure to be here. Thank you very much for the opportunity to share.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.